Hey, what's up guys, and welcome back to Anime King. And today I'm going to be giving you part 35 of What If Naruto Learned the Clone Secret in the Beginning. Remember to get this one to 100 likes as usual, share this to all of your friends in your social media platform, and also guys, go ahead and check out the brand new episode of What If Naruto Was Trained by All the Greats over on Anime King, and enjoy that. And I also post a new episode of What If Naruto Got His Memory Sealed Away. So go ahead and enjoy this all, guys. And remember, if you're new and this is the first time you hear my voice, and you enjoy the videos on both Animaking and Animaking 2, go ahead and click that red subscribe button and become a part of the Animaking family. And thank you for all of your help and your support. So without further ado, what do you say we begin this new episode? Start the intro. So, the last time we left off, when Naruto woke up, there was nothing. Nothing for him to see around. As he could only see the chaos. The hidden rain was in pure, unbridled chaos. As him and Nagato really went at it, but Naruto barely remembered what happened. As he couldn't see Nagato or Konan anywhere, all he could see was Akane, as she was lying on top of him. With her six tails, it seems like what Yami Naruto did to her took away some of her power. She now has six tails. And two fox ears at the side of her ears. And she looked rather beautiful. Naruto took her as he ran for hours, making his way out of the hidden rain, until exhaustion finally set in on his body. Whatever he had transformed into, the exhaustion, everything was coming. As he ended up passing out, but he saw someone before going under. We then had a time skip, as Obito was having a bad day. He was being attacked by the Raikage, B, and Yujito. As the three of them was attacking him and he couldn't use his Kamui power to get away, as Zetsu had went away earlier, going underground. As the man ran, as he faced off against them, trying his best to survive, something was interrupted with his power. He ended up getting caught off guard, and he got hit multiple times. As he got back, sturdy onto his feet and started to run again until he was attacked once more. Something was messing his power yet again, as he ended up getting caught right in their clutches. It was Raikage that caught him and grabbed him and threw him down to snap his neck, as Obito saw someone standing there. It was none other than Orochimaru, with his eyes. He had taken over Sasuke's body, and he was the one that killed Itachi. And those eyes that he has gained, the eternal Mangekyo Sharingan. As Obito fell, he apologized to Rin before he died. The three of them were under again Jutsu as they saw Orochimaru as, well, someone they can trust, and they were following his orders, as he told them to set out. Orochimaru is planning on invading Konoha with the entire Sound Force. And Kumo being the charging force, of course, as everything was going to start very soon. Meanwhile, when Naruto finally woke up, it was Fu. Fu was the one that was there, as Naruto had met her when he was on his training trip with Jiraiya. Speaking about Jiraiya, Jiraiya had died, and that was still weighing on his consciousness, as Akane has got some new clothes. After a day, they said goodbye, and with that they headed back to Konoha. Tsunade was surprised when she saw Akane, as Akane didn't wish to, well, do anything out of the ordinary. She just wanted to stay with Naruto. As Tsunade agreed with that, as she knew that it was some kind of bond between them. As she hadn't said anything about Jiraiya's death, even though she knew. It was welling up inside for her, she told Naruto that he can go, and he will have some day off. The moment he left, she broke down. As Akane spoke to Naruto when they got back home, she was jealous. She was jealous that Koyuki took his first time. She had seen him as a worthy mate, and she was jealous. That's why she decided to block him out. And yeah, Yami ended up capturing her. He never knew that she liked him, and now in this form, she looked so desirable as he kissed her. She kissed him back, and she wasted no time as the both of them did it together. We even had time skip as Aizumon Tetsu was on a random mission, as they were patrolling the borders when one of their female teammates came back as she was bloodied and bruised. As the jonin that was with them quickly jumped to her attention, as they looked to see Darui, the user of the black lightning, as he was here to battle. He told them that he couldn't go against the leader's orders after all. They didn't understand the situation, but they knew they had to fight for their life as they got their weapons. So yeah guys, so it's basically last spoiler stuff. You guys can switch across to the PlayStation for yourself. So what is going to be in this new episode? The two forces were standing in the branches. Either Katetsu or Aizumo made a move. This man was a jonin, just like their leader. "What should we do, leader?" asked Katetsu. Tatsuo didn't say anything, instead he screamed as Aizumo and Katetsu quickly turned back. Their eyes bulged as they saw four long nails piercing from Tatsuo's chest. As Tatsuo dropped the wounded comrade, who felt the ground a sharp crack as the nails were pulled from his back, as he collapsed forward, striking the ground head first. The person who had appeared behind Tatsuo was familiar to Katetsu. It was Yujito, but something was wrong. She had always had a smile on her face when coming to visit them, but now, her face was just blank. Her eyes were dead. They were emotionless. "No way. Yujito, why?" he said. But she said nothing. Storm release, laser circus. Several beams shot from the way, as Katetsu couldn't count the number of beams being blasted at him and Aizumo. It was bright enough that he almost felt blinded, but his body quickly moved though. But the beams curved as he jumped off the branch. A scream erupted from Katetsu as several beams struck him in the chest. The attack was so powerful, each beam tore through his body. It felt like his insides were being burned. As he fell to the ground, he tried to fight against the darkness crowding around his vision. He blinked once as he looked up to see Yujito standing above him, her body surrounded by blue flames. As she slashed down with her claws, tearing through his throat. Meanwhile, Darui dropped to the floor as he landed in a crouch as he looked over Aizumo. Aizumo was lying against a tree as he somehow managed to lean up against it before dying. His head lowered now as he was dead. As he glanced over to the other two, they were both dead. As he looked over at Katetsu, his throat was slashed open. As Yujito was cleaning her claws off, her expression nonchalant. It disturbed him that she could kill these Konoha shinobis. Well, with no sight of plague or nothing on her mind. "Hey, Yujito, do you know why the Raikage suddenly decided to go to war with Konoha?" he asked. "I don't, but does it really matter? We're shinobis. Our only job is to follow the orders of our Akagi. We don't need to worry about the hows and the whys." That was a very Yujito response, but at the same time he sent some distance to her words. It was like the words that she was speaking didn't match her own feelings on the matter. "Well, I suppose there is nothing that we can do," said Darui. "We are already committed to this," he says. He looked down at the corpses lying on the ground. "Yes, and now that the way is clear, let us get back to the main army," said Yujito. As they start to walk back to their forces that was waiting, Darui was confused why they didn't sound as attacked them. They gained a footing inside of Konoha, as he didn't see the tears leaking from Yujito's eyes. Not even herself seemed to have noticed as she was walking and yet crying, but she didn't seem to notice as she was crying. Time skip. An emergency meeting was called by the Hokage, Chunin and above, as they were all in a large venue. As Naruto was standing beside Kakashi and Sakura, who he spotted upon entering. There were so many people, he was lucky to find them. It was honestly thanks to their hair. Kakashi, spiky silver hair and soccer pink hair. "I don't suppose either of you know what this is about," said Naruto. Kakashi shook his head no as he flipped a page in his book. As Sakura crossed her arms, "I don't have a clue," Sakura said, "but I imagine something serious given how every ninja above Genin rank has been summoned." "Ah, Kakashi, my youthful rival," said Guy as he broke through the crowd. "This is the most unexpected meeting, isn't it? Why, Young Lee and I was just returning from a mission when you just got this call to come. Here, do you have any idea what is going on?" "No. I'm afraid I don't know either," said Kakashi, as the rest of Guy's team walked up to them. "That's too bad," Guy said. "Tenten," said Naruto. "Hey, I see you're back from your mission. How what's wrong?" she said, as she noticed the look on his face. "I'll tell you later," he said, as Snivy appeared. She was standing on a stage as she was elevated so everyone could see her. She had an aura of strength and confidence, but there was bags under her eyes. He imagined that she hadn't been sleeping well since he returned with the news about Jerry's death. "We have a grave situation on our hands," Nadia said, as Shizune was by her side. "We just received a report on the border of High Nakune and Yu Nakune that several Kumo ninjas attack our border patrol base. Furthermore, we received an attack that Taki Shinobu's attack from Shinobis on the Hidden Stone. While they were able to fend them off, the Taki leader sent a report that several thousand stone ninjas passed through the border, coming towards High Nakune. A wave of unease spread through the crowd. By this point, Kakashi has closed his book as he placed it in his pouch. "Do we know if Kumo has gathered an army similar to Hidden Stone?" he asks. "We do not know that, but it's safe to presume that they have. That said, right now we don't have enough information to make a decision. But it was confirmed that Kumo attack and annihilate one of our border patrols, correct?" asked Neji. "Correct," said Snivy. "Of that, there is no doubt. More murmurs swept through the crowd. This doesn't make any sense, Naruto said. What? Said Tenten. Ignore Naruto for the moment, Naruto stepped forward. Lady Hokage, doesn't this seem strange? While our hostilities with the Hidden Stone has always been present, we'd make great roads with Kumo. Why? Will they attack us now? Tsunade hesitated to answer, which made Naruto step forward. Perhaps they are finally showing their true colors. Kumo has always been a greedy nation that covers the many Kekigenkai that Konoha possess, including the Byakugan. My own father was a victim of their schemes. Maybe their alliance was just that, a scheme, to make us drop our own guard. Naruto shook his head. That is what just doesn't make sense. If it was a scheme to make us drop our guard so they could kidnap Kekigenkai users, they wouldn't have launched an attack on our borders. They would have used the alliance to sneak a few ninja in, quietly kidnap our shinobi and left before we could do anything. Their actions here are counterproductive. Neji looked like he wanted to argue, but he paused as he saw Naruto point. It was true, now that Konoha was aware of what happened here, stealing Kekigenkai users would be very hard to do. That meant their purpose was something else. You bring up a good point, Neji said. I retract my earlier statement. What they're doing right now doesn't make much sense. Whatever the case may be, the fact is we don't have enough information about the current situation to make any informed decisions. I will be putting all of our forces on a state of high alert. Furthermore, several fierce squads will receive missions to do reconnaissance. We also need to deal with the Hidden Stone. According to Shibuki, the leader of Taki, the Stone Force's number includes several thousands. However, I suspect those are only the forces that he was able to see. I'll be giving all of your orders at some point. So, remain on standby and wait for further instructions, said Tsunade. While everyone responded that yes, Lady Hokage, Naruto heard an unsettling sound. The Hidden Stone was bringing an army into their country, and Kumo attacked their border, and me. Also, have an army on the way. He didn't say anything, but this looked like the beginning of another shinobi war. But he hoped that wasn't the case. Time skip. To say that Tenten was surprised was an understatement, as she found out that the redhead was actually Kayube. As Naruto was bombarded with questions after, she recalled her senses. And Naruto went to make them some lunch. And they actually sat down and talked. Well, that was good. At least they weren't trying to kill each other. Later that night, Naruto was currently lying down, as he was only wearing boxers. Akane, not used to sleeping in nothing, had gone nude as she was lying on top of him, holding him close like he was a pillow. Her eyes were closed, it looked like she had fallen asleep. But he knew better. Can't sleep, she asked. He shook his head. I'm worried about you, Jito, he said. She buried her face deeper into his chest. That Jinjūki of the Nebi, she said, if I'm not mistaken, she's a Kumo shinobi. Yes. And you're worried that you have to fight her. If they launch an attack against Konoha. Once more. That's right. Them and the Hidden Stone, said Naruto. I don't know about that one, said Akane. But you are concerned whether or not if you have to fight her. Not just that. My biggest concern is that something has happened to her. I honestly can't see her agreeing to fight against us. I mean, she spent so much time here and she and I became close. Would she really be willing to fight us? Hard to say, but she is shinobi. So I believe that she would betray someone she cares about to obey her ninja village. Isn't that what being a ninja is about? Why, Akane said in a rather cynical way. Naruto couldn't deny her words because he knew that it was true. Ninjas were taught to put the village above everything else. And Yujito was a loyal ninja. If her Kage told her to betray Konoha, she would do it. Even if she didn't like it. What will you do if she's the enemy? Asked Akane. I don't know, said Naruto. Well, whatever decision you make, I'll be there to support you. I have decided to stay by your side even as a seal is no longer keeping us together. So I'll help you if I can. Thank you, Akane. That means a lot to me, said Naruto. It had better, she said, as she snuggled up more. Time skip. Another mass meeting has been called by Tsunade, as the ninjas were gathered. I received several reports last night, she said. Kumo forces have entered our border and set up a base outside of a small town called Teijuki, K. It doesn't look like they harm any of the citizens, but their numbers are greater than we expected. Our last report put their numbers at 1,000 ninjas. What's more, said Tsunade, the Hidden Stone has finally encroached on our border. They hold themselves up in a ravine in Hainokune. We finally got an estimation on their numbers. It's 3,000 shinobis. As Naruto could hear the murmurs all around, Konoha had a total of 5,000 genins in their forces. But that is if they were willing to include the genins, who made up 60% of their ninja forces. Becoming a chunin was difficult. It required participating in chunin exams. And becoming a jonin was even more difficult. The fact that the Hidden Stone brought so much people told him one of two things. They had far more elite ninja at their disposal than anyone realized. Or, they were using genin to bolster their numbers. We do not have the forces to meet Kumo and the stone, Snaddy said. However, I sent a message last night to the Sand and Kiri, and received a reply this morning. Both of them had agreed to help us. The Sand is going to meet us out to help us combine the forces of the stone army, seeing that they're greater than Kumo by far. Do we know if Kumo and the stone has formed an alliance? Asked Kakashi. We do not, Snaddy said, and judging from their lack of coordination and behavior, we believe that they're not allied with each other. But these two attacking at the same time is couldn't be a mere coincidence. Then you think someone is manipulating these events near the axe? It is entirely possible and we certainly cannot leave it out. However, we have no evidence that this is true either. Nerd frowned as he thought about the situation and the lack of information that they had. He learned how important information was thanks to Jiraiya, as they knew nothing entirely beyond guesswork. What's more, they only had numbers and nothing else. They didn't know what those forces were comprised of or what they should watch out for, or if there was a force working in the shadows. I'll be dividing all of you into two divisions, said Snelly. Your division will determine where you go. Furthermore, I'll choose in first and second commanders for each division. First division will be traveling to meet up with the Sand forces. Second forces will be traveling to meet up with Kiri forces. My guy, you will be in charge of the first division. Neji is your second in command. Leave it to me, late Hokage guy said as he gave a salute as he grinned. It was good to see not even a war could affect his attitude. I'll do my best to serve you, Lady Hokage, said Neji. As she then turned to Kakashi, you're going to be in charge of Division 2, Kakashi. And Naruto will be your second in command. I understand, Lady Hokage, said Kakashi. Please, leave it to us, said Naruto. Right, Snaddy nodded at them both. Now let's talk about how the divisions are going to be divided. Konoha had 2,000 ninjas to use in their forces, since they refused to use the genins to fight in a war. 1,500 will make up the first division, while the other 500 would use to make up the second division. But they were still outnumbered on both fronts. But it was Snaddy hope that Kiri and the Sand Forces would help them even out their ranks. There was only two problems that she could see. It's going to take some time for the Sand and Kiri to reach us, said Snaddy. The Sand will probably arrive a day or two after we do. And it takes at least a week for someone to travel from Kiri by boat. That means both of our forces have to hold out until the Sand and Kiri arrive to reinforce us. As Snaddy was talking, Nerd noticed odd about one of the ninjas in their ranks. He didn't recognize the man. While this didn't mean much because he didn't know every Konoha ninja by name, this one was acting strangely. He couldn't put his finger on it, but he could tell that something was up. After the meeting ended, Naruto created two clones. One was to trail the man. The other was to trail his own child clone in case the first one dispelled. Kakashi, they need to pack a lot before leaving because they were traveling as an army after all. Kakashi was taking care of his supplies as Naruto was helping him. Fortunately, Naruto had shadow clones, so things were quite easy there. Using the storehouse near the gate, Naruto and Kakashi gathered all the scrolls that ninja gave to them, which they were going to seal the things inside of. Each person was marked with gathering different supplies as they marked on the scroll what they had gathered. As they were, Naruto told Kakashi about the strange person he saw at the meeting. And you think this person might be a spy? Said Kakashi after Naruto explained what he saw. I don't know, said Naruto as he wrote something down on a piece of paper after studying the stack of scrolls in front of him. The problem is I have no conclusive evidence to suggest that he's a spy. But something about him felt off, like I was staring at a distorted reflection. Maybe it was a genjutsu, said Kakashi. Maybe, said Naruto. But he didn't believe so because he knew that he would have saw genjutsu. In either event, I have two shy clones sealing him. While I wish you'd have informed me of this sooner, I think you made the right choice by using your clones to tail this person. Thank you. Naruto suddenly stopped. As he saw the image of a person back walking down a dark hallway before everything went black. What is it? Said Kakashi. My first clone was just dispelled. I'll be right back, said Naruto. Before Kakashi should tell him otherwise, Naruto used replacement technique and replaced himself with the second clone. The place that Naruto ended up was a dark hallway with several passages. He didn't know what this place was, but the entrance was located in one of the abandoned sections of Konoha. As he traveled down the hall, using the memory of the first clone to retrace their step, someone attacked his first shadow clone from behind. They were also good enough to sneak up on him, as he needed to keep cautious. As he reached a door and placed his two fingers against it, as he sent wind chakra inside like a sonar, trying to map out the area behind it. There was two people inside, but the moment his wind chakra made contact with one of them, a burst of static filled his head. It felt like someone disrupted his technique by shoving their own chakra into the air. Shaking his head to clear it, Naruto returned to the door and sent more chakra inside, as the second person was now gone. As Naruto quickly unlocked the door, as he opened it just a crack and peeped inside, as he couldn't see anything, he opened it more and swept his gaze around the room. He looked empty at first, but then he saw a lump lying on the floor. As he made his way towards the object after opening it, the lump was actually a body. It was the body of a person that he was following. This young man looked slightly older than him. He had a pale face and black eyes that were glazed over in death. and wore black clothing, a kunai pouches at his hip. There were no other identifying marks, as Naruto placed a hand on the person's neck to make sure, confirming it. This person was dead, but when he sent chakra into their body, he found something interesting. There was foreign chakra residue inside of them. As Naruto sealed away the body, as he wanted to preserve the chakra that was inside this person's body, he needed to show Tsunade this, who probably sent the body to the hospital or autopsy team. With luck, they will learn something useful. Time skip. Several days passed by in a blink. As Naruto told Tsunade what he found, as Tsunade had give Shizune and Sakura the job to check it out and find out what was going on. As Tsunade told that they wouldn't change their plans, as all of them were in front of the gate, ready. Looks like everyone is here, said Kakashi. Seems that way, said Naruto. Aren't one of you going to give a speech, a last minute speech or something? Asked Akane. As she was standing beside Naruto dressed in a dark kimono, dark red, a large gap in the front of the kimono made her cleavage spill out, as the kimono parted at her legs. She wasn't wearing any sandals, but that didn't surprise Naruto, because she hated footwear. Why are you here again, Kakashi asked, in a bored tone of voice. I have the Hokage permission to come along, Akane said. Besides, you know who I am, right? She said. I am perfectly aware of who you are, said Kakashi. And it's because I know who you are, that is why I am weary of letting you come with us. While Akane didn't seem to be bothered by Kakashi's words, Naruto glanced towards him. I know you don't trust her, but I do, so please give her the benefit of the doubt. Kakashi sighed. He didn't know the relationship between Naruto and Akane. Well, Naruto hadn't told him that they were intimate. That said, he was sure that Kakashi suspected that they were close. Fine, you have the Hokage permission to join us anyway. It's not like I can say anything, as a smug smirk came on her face, as he then turned towards the division. Alright, we're moving out. Be ready to travel swiftly. We're not going to stop until we reach there. And with that, they all turned and raced out of the gate. Meanwhile, Tsunade went down to the hospital. Lady Hokage said Inuichi as he turned to face the woman as he bowed. I'm surprised to see you're still here, she said. I figure that I would keep working on this, he says. He gestured towards the medical table. Called me paranoid, but I figure there is something about this body that I cannot leave unsolved. I have a feeling that it can prove dangerous if we don't learn all that we can. Tsunade nodded as she agreed with him, of course. Have you learned anything? Not as much as I would like, but I learned something. Shizune and Sakura perform an autopsy, but they couldn't find anything. It seems he was just an average chunin with no special abilities or anything. That's only partly true, said Inuichi. Naruto mentioned that he found traces of chakra inside this person. I was able to retrace this chakra and find remnants of a jutsu being used. Do you know what kind of jutsu? Unfortunately, no, I don't. But I have a guess. Let's call it a hunch. What is it? Asked Nadi. I heard about something happening in the sand when Gar was kidnapped. A man named Yura was a sleeper agent working for Sorcerer of the Red Sand. A technique called Senoseno Jutsu was used on him. Basically, a small needle is planted in the target's memory and seal away his memories. This allowed them to safely spy on the enemy for a long period of time. No one knows he's a spy, not even himself, which allowed him to spy without getting catch on. And you think this person has a similar jutsu used on them, asked Nadi. Yes. Tsunade bit her thumb as something unsettling caused her stomach to turn. If this was true, then that means they had made a sleeper agent like this one. That was not a pleasant thought. However, there was another issue. She had no idea who the sleeper agent belonged to. None whatsoever. And that was what scared her the most. Timescape. The group arrived at the town, but they didn't step foot inside because they didn't want to, well, rile up the locals. So they camped 2 kilometers away from the village. As they set up their tents, fires were created and everything. As Kakashi headed towards the town, as he left Naruto in charge after all, he was second in command. When Kakashi wasn't here, he was in charge. As he was going to meet with their allies from Kiri. As Naruto sent out some clones to scout the perimeter all around them. As there were about 80 tents all around them. There was the largest tent in the center that Sakura and the other medical squad was set up in. As Naruto reached the tent that he was sharing with Akane and Team 10. He saw Choji and Shikamaru and Asuma was getting everything ready while Ino chatting with Akane. Team 10 did not know who Akane was yet. Only a few people like Tenten, Kakashi, and Sakura were. To everyone else, she was just a beautiful, skilled mercenary that Naruto has grown close to. During his travels, that was their cover story. You're not serious, Ino was shouting as the two of them sat in a log and talked. Then, you and Naruto have her face turned red. Yes, said Akane. Naruto and I have sex most nights. As Ino leaned forward, but what about Tenten? Tenten has had sex with us too, said Akane. What? Said Ino. Huh, that's quite the reaction, said Naruto as he walked up. Naruto, how long have you been there, said Ino. Long enough to hear your conversation about my sexual habits. Anyway, Ino, you can't leave all the work to your teammates. Why don't you help them out by setting up the sleeping bags? As she saw the others working, as she slumped. Yeah, I'll help out, she said. As she then turned to Akane. But you're going to tell me more about what we were talking about later. Sure, it's the cunning, if that is what you want. As Naruto watched her say something to Shikamaru and Choji before heading inside the tent. Making friendly by telling her about her sex life, said Naruto. Ino said that she was curious about her sex life, said Akane. I was merely giving her some of the details. It always surprised me, no matter the era. Young girls like her always gossip about the same things. And that is, Naruto said. Oh, boys. Relationship and sex. I should have figured that, said Naruto. Naruto didn't know why, but he felt like they were being watched. But his clones never alerted him of anything. After all, his clones are everywhere, transformed into various animals and objects. Maybe it's one of the Konoha ninja. It didn't feel quite hostile, but it felt strange. In the end, all he could do was remain on alert. Timescape, Naruto clones reach the city in a day. As the Kumo army was still there, but they haven't hurt anyone. His clones dispelled themselves one by one, allowing Naruto to have a clear picture of what they were doing. The only thing that seemed off was that Naruto couldn't find anyone that looked like their commanding officer. The first sign of trouble became as the group was sitting around eating dinner. During that time, several of Naruto clones were dispelled. It happened so fast that none of the memories he got back could tell him what happened to them. As the seals on his hands started to warm up, this made him know that foreign chakra signatures had entered the campsite. Screams then came from the woods. Everyone get ready, Naruto says, he stood up from the log. Hostile forces enter the camp, wet sight, he said. Asuma, Shikamaru, check the perimeter on the other side. There's a chance they might attack in multiple directions. Ino, head over to the hospital and help Sakura. Choji, I want you to alert everyone who is under attack about everything. Tell them to be on the lookout for other intruders. Yes, sir. As Naruto had Akane follow him as he raced towards where the intruders were. Do you know how many there are, she asked. He shook his head, the signal doesn't tell me how many intruders there are. It just alert me to when a front chakra signature enter the field. Well, that's lame, she said. At least I can know when there's danger, he said. As the both of them arrived to a shinobi battle. As there were Kumo shinobis. There were over 12 of them. They weren't even hiding their identity that they were Kumo shinobis. Their headbands were proudly on display. They were using a combination of lightning and sword techniques to fight against the Konoha ninja. But they didn't have the upper hand. The Konoha ninja had responded to the threat. As Naruto was glad that he tied several other ninja to the seals all around. Let's help them out, said Naruto. As he recognized some of them, he recognized Darui. He also saw Team Samui fighting against Konoha ninjas some ways away. Help the ones dealing with Samui and her team, Naruto instructed. Try not to kill the Kumo ninjas, capture them if you can. That's a very tall order, but I will see what I can do, said Akane. As she rushed forward where Samui and her team was. Once that was happening, Naruto flashed as he appeared right in front of Darui, the quick Sanjin. As the man's eyes widened in surprise, he had to quickly substitute. The wrestling gun that Naruto created pulverized a log in front of him. As Naruto looked at the injured ninjas that were fighting Darui. If you're still able to fight, then help your Konoha ninja, he said. If you aren't, head to the hospital. Leave Darui to me. As they dispersed, as Naruto turned towards Darui. It's been a while, hasn't it, said Naruto. Darui's face was like a grimace and a smile. Yes, it has, he said. I haven't seen you since Jiraiya. And you arrived in Kumo last year to train with Killer B. Why? Why is Kumo attacking us, said Naruto? I wish I knew the answer myself, said Darui, as he went through hand sign. All I can say is that our Raikages ordered us to attack Konoha, as he fired off beams of lightning that came towards Naruto. Naruto slammed his hands on the ground and channeled wind chakra through his body. Wind release, tornado jutsu, as a massive tornado formed on Naruto, ripping apart the blast that Darui sent towards him. While the tornado kept going, Naruto created a clone, as he substituted a small leaf above Darui. As Darui saw it and quickly canceled his jutsu as he pulled his blade and blocked the clone strike. As Naruto dispelled his jutsu and leapt at Darui from low. As Darui dispelled a clone and attacked Naruto. As the two of them engaged in a fierce close range battle. As Darui started channel lightning chakra through his sword to increase the cutting power. As Naruto channeled wind chakra through his kunais. As wind was strong against lightning. As that negate Darui advantage. As Naruto kunai started cut into the cleaver sword. Making Darui jump away. Lightning release, Black Panther, he said. As a Black Panther came towards Naruto. Naruto extend his wind as he created a massive blade from pure wind as Darui enhanced the Black Panther with another jutsu, water release, water blast. The power of the Black Panther increased and so did its size as it towered over Naruto. As Naruto ripped right through the front leg, but the thing still swiped at him with the other one. As Naruto ducked, wind release, wind bullet. As he fired at a massive wind bullet that smashed into the panther's head. As it dispersed the jutsu and continued on to Darui. Darui dodged as the thing struck the tree, but that was just as bad. The thing exploded as Darui was thrown like he was a rag doll. As he quickly substituted the log. as Naruto created a massive wind dome around him, like a sonar. As Akane had done it, all team members of Samui were knocked out and tied up. Good, now he had just captured Darui. Maybe then he would get some answers. As Darui was trying to sneak up behind Naruto unaware, then Naruto can see everything because of his jutsu. As Naruto allowed him to get close, he then spin and block Darui's sword. As Naruto sliced right through it, as Darui leaped back in shock, trying to gain some distance. But Naruto did not allow it as he pressured the man with swift punch and kicks. As Naruto started getting some good hits as Darui was being knocked around. Just when it looked like Naruto was going to win, something descended from the sky at terrible speed. Naruto jumped back as the thing dropped to the ground, tearing through the spot that he was standing. He then focused as he saw it was a person. Yujito? She looked at Naruto, but then she looked away. Oh, we're surprised that attack failed. We're retreating now. Right. This mission was a dull bust, said Darui, as he got up, his body aching in pain. Do you really think I'm gonna let you get away, Naruto asked. I do, Yujito said. You see, I'm not the only Jinjuri here. Killer B is also here. If you don't let us leave, he will turn to the Eight Hills and rampage through your camp. Naruto couldn't tell if she was bluffing or not, but he knew that the Raikage didn't let his little brother leave Kumo very often. In fact, ever since Akatsuki began their attack, Killer B was confined to the village. That said, if she wasn't bluffing, why didn't they use him at the start to rampage through their border? Or perhaps because they knew that he was here, and he could also seal away their power. But still, they would get a lot of advantage done before he sealed them away. Knowing that he couldn't afford to attack when there's a possibility that what she said was true. As Naruto didn't chase when they disappeared in the shadows, as all of the others went away, we've beaten Kumo back. But don't. Let yourself become complacent, said Naruto. There's still a lot of work to do. In this battle, Konoha only lost one squad of 4, bringing their number down to 496. Two squads were injured, but their injury wasn't that bad. Similarly, only a squad of Kumo shinobis were killed, but they also had Team Samui in capture, thanks to Akane. As Naruto created a clone and informed Kakashi about what happened, then he made for the command tent as he saw Akane standing over Amoi, Samui, and Karu. They were awake, their chakra was sealed, and their wrist was bound. Have they said anything? Asked Naruto. Not a word, said Akane. As Naruto kneeled down and looked at all of them, well, Samui had a cool look on her face. Karu was just glaring at him like she wanted to bite his head off, as Amoi was silent, looking at the ground. As he then sat down, I don't suppose any of you know why Kumo would just suddenly attack Konoha. Neither of them said anything. Do none of you find it strange that your Raikage just attacked Konoha out of the blue like this? If you don't talk to me, then I'll have Ino mind rape you until all of your secrets are revealed. We have no idea what the Raikage is thinking, said Samui. Ever since the Chunin exams that you and Yujito participate in, Raikage has been striving to make inroads on our alliance. However, a few months ago he changed his mind and said we were going to war with Konoha. It does seem strange, but we are shinobi. We have to follow orders, regardless. It sounds to me that the Raikage is being manipulated by someone, said Naruto. There is no way that's possible, said Karu. Lord Raikage will never allow anyone to manipulate him. Then how do you explain the sudden change, Naruto asked. She looked uncertain, even though she was a hothead. She knew that this attack was, well, strange. It was strange in many, many ways. He just switched so quickly from working with Konoha and he started war with them, out of the blue. While I understand why you think, Lord, Raikage is being manipulated, you must also be reminded that he's surrounded by powerful ninjas and he's also our Raikage, said Samui. There are very few ninja in this world that are strong enough to fight on even terms with him. I understand what you're getting at, said Naruto. However, I think it's because of that confidence you're displaying why my idea is merit, said Naruto. If what you're saying is true, then who will be capable of controlling Akagi, said Samui. I have a few guesses, but nothing concrete yet. But if my hunches are correct, then spell out of trouble for everyone, said Naruto. As he left, Akane to guard Samui and her team as he head towards the hospital. As he nodded at Sakura were helping the 4 wounded. As the other 3 were sleeping, but the other one, he had a gash along his chest that Sakura was healing as he made his way towards Ino. Oh, what's up, Naruto, she said. I want you to interrogate Team Samui. I want you to find out anything about Kumo's army. Any special Kekkeninkai user we need to watch out for and what their plans are. Use drugs to make their mind more easy to access if you have to, but try not to damage them. If what I'm thinking is correct, then Kumo might be victims more than we are. Ino was confused, but she got to work. As Naruto then left and climbed one of the tallest trees as he created some more clones to replace the one that were destroyed. Somewhere in this forest was Yujito. What was he gonna do about her? Kakashi was still gone, so he was in charge until then. Time skip, 2 days passed, as Samui and her team was still under constant guard. There had been no further attacks, but Naruto discovered by his clones that Kumo army was no longer in the town. He was worried, something was off. Naruto, as Ino entered the command tent. I finished interrogating those three ninjas. Did you find out anything?
Yes, I discovered a bit, she said.
They confirmed that Kumo army is 1,000 strong. It consists mostly of Chunin, but there's one Jonin for every squadron. The person in charge is Darui. His second in command is Yujito. I couldn't find out their commands. It's because those three don't know them.
I see.
And what of Killer B?
Does they know if he's within the army near the axe?
He isn't, said Ino.
So, she blocked me, said Naruto.
Damn it, I should have gone after them. When Ino looked uncertain, he waved her off.
It's nothing. Thank you for the report. Get some rest, he said.
As Ino left, Naruto rubbed his face. So what's the plan now? Asked Akane.
Now, we wait.
We don't even know where Kumo army is, so we can't do anything else but wait.
Waiting, huh? I once heard from our old soldier several centuries ago that waiting was the worst part of war.
I think I'm starting to understand what he meant. Waiting for something to happen really sucks.
Yeah, said Naruto. I really, really hate waiting.
Time skip. As Naruto was sitting down still in the command tent, when he saw several shadows dispel.
This is not good, he said. What's wrong?
Asked Akane. There's a large force of Kumo ninjas heading right towards us.
Oh, that's not good.
Not good at all, said Naruto. As he sent a clone to inform Kakashi about what is going on. As he called out ninjas by sending out his clones to get them ready. As they all gather in front of the command tent. As Naruto used wind chakra to levitate himself above everyone. So they could see him as he extended his voice. Kumo army is on the move near to inform them. They are currently heading this way, which means they plan on confronting us. Their army is larger, outnumbered 2 to 1 here. That said, we still hold every other advantage, besides numbers. This is our homeland, our turf. We know it better than them. We can use the terrain to our advantage. I have a plan to deal with their force, Naruto said. Our ultimate goal in this fight is not to kill them, but to stop them from killing us. That means we need to be clever, Naruto said, as he started to inform them of his plan. Meanwhile, Yujito was marching at the head of Kumo's army with Darui, the Jonin in command. His expression was grim as Team Samui was captured in their assault. I don't think I'll have to remind you, but you and I will have to engage her together if we want to win, said Darui. Because their army was 1,000 strong, they had to move through the forest slowly. It would take at least an hour for a small squadron to reach, but it will take seven for them.
I know, said Yujito. You and I are going to engage Naruto in combat, while our army take care of the rest of the Konoha forces.
Once that is done, if we haven't killed Naruto, our army will surround him and unleash a barrage of ninjutsu. Not even he would withstand such an attack.
Of course, should he unleash his Bijuu, I'll be relying on you, said Darui.
I know, she said. Are you really okay with this, he asked. I know it's too late for us to do anything now, but you're being ordered to kill someone you're close to. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I could have sworn that you were in love with that guy. Yujito did not like the thought of killing Naruto, but she tried not to think about it. This is an order from a Raikage. She couldn't disobey orders. Of course I disliked the idea, but orders are orders.
That's dull, he said.
Given that Kumo was on the mountainside, Darui think that he have gotten lost many times. But Yujito know where she was going. It was fortunate through the alliance where she had traveled to Konoha back in front that she know the terrain. They soon arrived at the clearing where Konoha campsite should have been located. It wasn't there anymore. As they stirred the empty camp, the tents were still there, several fires were still there, but no one was there.
What the? Did they all move out already? Asked Darui.
It's possible. That Naruto received an advance warning, she said. I bet you anything he created more cyclones and had them wait on guard for us. He probably knew that we were coming for several hours and had his forces abandon the camp. But why bring out such a large force if you're not going to fight, said Darui. Knowing Naruto, he probably has a plan. And we definitely won't like it, she said. He ordered the army to spread around. A third of their forces were ordered to retreat and stay back in case of an ambush. There was no indication that anyone left, not even footsteps. A large army like that couldn't erase their tracks so easily. It took time. But they found nothing, no sign of anything. Just as a cold chill swept through her body, she heard screams as a good portion of their ninjas were covered up to their necks. At least 7 dozen of them were trapped in the dirt. Several hundred shuriken and kunai then fly down towards them, as she and the others tried to defend the others that were trapped. As ninjas then emerged from the ground, and more of them appeared from the surrounding forest. As Yujito could see, a Inuzaka tearing through her forces with a dog. A Hayuga tearing through them with their Jayuken. A Aberamin that uses bugs to drain them of their chakra. And the Inoshika Cho, the next generation. As the combined effort, the Konoha ninjas decimate their forces rather easily. Lightning release, electric shot needles, as Darui threw his hand in the air and fired off thousands of tiny blue needles. As that was a signal, as the rest of the ninjas then rushed into the battle. The battle started to become equal as the rest of the forces arrived. Just as it looked like the battle was going to turn to your favor,
a flash appeared in front of Yujito and smashed right into her. She grunted, but then something smashed into her back, and again and again and again and again. Oddly enough, the attacks didn't really hurt. They sting a bit, but they were to get her away from the main battlefield. She coated her body in lightning chakra. A yell echoed from her attacker as he got shocked a bit, as he backed off, as she looked to see who she was fighting. Naruto. Meanwhile, Akane. It's been a long time since she fought, one-on-one. As a black panther came towards her, she raised her hand as a red barrier was created, as it dissipated the black panther like it was nothing. What sort of jutsu is that, said the Rui. It's not a jutsu at all, she said. She released the barrier. It's just... As she held out her hand, as they became enveloped in the red chakra. Chakra manipulation. You must have some seriously. Strong chakra control to manipulate it like that. I'm even better than Snaddy at this, she said. Well, that's pretty dull for me, he said. As he created a clone, and him and the clone went to the same hand sign. This time, two black panthers came at Akane. She leaped forward as she swung her feet, as she sliced through the first panther with ease. As she planted her foot back and ground, lifted her heel and pierced the next panther. Her legs were glowing in the same red chakra as before. That isn't normal chakra, said Darui. I feel like I've seen this chakra before, but it couldn't be. He probably thought that this was yokai, but he couldn't accept it. On the off chance that he accept what he was seeing, he probably think that she was a Jinjutsu like Naruto. Since you was kind enough to show me some of your techniques, let me show you one of mine, she said. What? Said Darui. As something wrapped around his leg, as he looked down to see a red tail from the ground. He turned his eyes as they widened as he noticed the tails emerging from her back. Oh, this is so he couldn't finish his sentence, she hurled him to the air and smashed him back in the forest floor. But he quickly substituted a log, as she created another red dome, as a bolt of lightning smashed right into it. She spun and pointed towards where he was and fired off a beam of her engine. He had to move as the thing destroyed the trees. As Dory looked back and whistled, as the thing destroyed several more trees behind him. Not only do you have an odd way of using chakra, but you're quite the powerhouse. I never heard of a ninja with your unique talents. A person of your strength should be famous by now. I like to keep our low profile, she said, as she disappeared. So fast, he thought, as he barely had time to remove his blade, as she appeared in front of him and attacked. As he jumped away, but something then grabbed him, as he looked down to see more tails. As he took a good look at her, as he saw fox ears, were on the side of her, no way, are you correct? As her fangs start to show, I am indeed the Kayube, and if you know what's good for you, you're going to call off your forces. Suddenly, more ninjas then flood into the clearing. These were not Kumo or Konoha ninjas. Kiri ninjas. Oh my. Looks like our reinforcements have arrived, said Akane. Now you really don't stand a chance, she said. As Daru sighed, suddenly, a massive burst of chakra made everyone freeze. Meanwhile, Yujito went all out the moment Naruto came in front of her. As the chakra shroud of a cat could be seen behind her, she lashed out with tails. As she pulled the trees on the root with her tails and threw them towards Naruto, as he ripped them apart with his chakra. As the wind, chakra was around him, slicing up everything. She ripped several more from the ground and threw them towards him as he ripped them apart once again. Why are you doing this, Yujito? She said nothing. Why? Is Kumo attacking Konoha? Are we no longer friends? He asked. He ducked from a tree. Do you no longer like me? He asked. That last comment made her twitch. It's not like I no longer like you. However, she said, I must simply follow the orders of my Kage. We ninjas are weapons. More so us Jinjutsukis. I am only doing what the weapon is supposed to do. If that's true, then why are you crying? Naruto said, as tears were coming from her eyes. Weapons, do not cry. Shut up, she said, as she rushed forward and sliced at him. But Naruto dodged each of her strikes before planting a firm kick in her chest, knocking her straight up. She then opened her mouth as numerous orbs started to gather around her. The orbs gathered into a single black sphere as she swallowed the orb as her stomach expanded. As she fired, but a large red barrier erupted right in front of the Bijuu bomb. Well now, this is problematic, said Akane as she stepped out. Not really, I could have blocked it as well, said Naruto. That's not what I meant, said Akane. That girl is under the influence of a very powerful and subtle genjutsu. What? As Yujito transformed fully, I could probably release her from that genjutsu, but you have to knock her out of this version 2 state. If you can knock her unconscious, then that would be even better. As she came at him, he blocked her attacks. He flipped around her and grabbed her by the waist and lifted her up as he smashed her into the ground. Snap out of it, he shouted. As she still kept on attacking him. I'm sorry, he said. As Naruto started to change. As it's been a while since he entered his hybrid mode. Because he was afraid to make Yami get stronger because it seemed that would happen. But for right now, he didn't have any choice. As he grabbed her hand, his body changing exponentially. He looked right into her eyes before smashing a fist right into her face. Her body was sent hurtling. In a blur, he descended from the sky and dropped right on top of her as her body smashed in the ground. She turned as she opened her mouth to form another bomb as he smashed her head down hard into the ground, disrupting the bitch bomb from her doing anything. As she struggled, as she tried to lash out with a claw, Naruto held up his fist as he started to channel chakra and drive it down. Boom! The entire ground underneath her exploded as she reverted back to normal, knocked out completely. As he placed a finger to her neck, as he then released a sigh of relief, as he calmed himself, he then gestured to Akane. "You said you could undo the genjutsu," Naruto asked. "Yes. I have first-hand experience with this genjutsu. Just leave it to me." As she placed her hand on Yujito's head. But guys, let me end this episode right here. If it was the next part of this episode, no do. Like, subscribe, comment down below, and turn the bell notification as they posted. And remember, share to all of your friends in your social media platform. But I'm over now. See you guys soon. Peace.